We come to the Lord this morning, meet with Him, and we come with expectation. Expectation to see Jesus. And behold, the leper came to Him and knelt before Him, saying, Lord, if You will, let this be the Sunday that we come with Him to Him, saying, Lord, if You will, You can make me clean. And Jesus stretched out His hand and touched him, saying, I will be clean. And immediately his leprosy was cleansed. In your heart this morning, leave aside all worries, concerns, and desires and say, Lord, if You will, let's meet Him this morning. And let our prayers be sincere to receive what He has for us. Not like Bob's wife. Bob forgot their anniversary. And she was not happy. And she said, tomorrow morning for you to make up, when I wake up, there better be something in the driveway that goes from 0 to 206 seconds. Next morning, she woke up with anticipation, looked outside the window, and there was a box in the middle of the driveway. And as she went to open it, there was a bathroom wait stand. Things that we ask from the Lord and the things that He says you need. I got that from my wife, by the way. I don't think it had an address to it, but it's something to make us wonder, the things that we ask and expect of the Lord. Let's stand. Lord, if you will, Lord, I pray that today we would have met with Jesus and heard His voice and seen the Word spoken to each one of us. Father, our Father, which art in heaven, and our Father, which are in our hearts, through the Holy Spirit. We surrender to You this very moment. We repent of our sin, and we call upon Your name as we are thirsty for Your Word. We leave at Your feet all the questions, worries, and concerns we may have had this week, the unknown of tomorrow. Block those out by looking at You, Lord, in Your Scripture. And in doing so, transform our lives that we would understand how we should then live in these times. Bless Your church in this place and in this nation, that we would be a praying church, a soul-winning church, a comforting church, a church that loves You more than any man, any woman, any message, the light, that we want You, Father, to be the ruler and king of our hearts. Accept our worship today, for we will sing with our hearts surrendered to You, awaiting for You, Lord Jesus, to come back. In the name of Jesus we pray. Amen. Remain standing.
Good morning. Good to see all of you here this morning. As I've commented before, I hope you're all warmed up and ready to sing here this morning, because that's what we are here for. We are here to lift our voices and praise to the Lord. And you know, as we do that, Scripture talks about that singing being a sacrifice of praise. I was reading something yesterday in one of the minor prophets, Hosea, I believe, and it commented on let the worship of our lips be as a bullock that is sacrificed to the Lord. That's the sacrifice the Lord wants to hear. The Lord doesn't want a bull sacrificed up here on the altar. He wants to hear the sacrifice of our lips. So let's sing our lift our voices this morning as we sing How Great Thou Art.
O Lord my God, when I in awesome wonder consider all the works Thy hands have made, I see the stars, I hear the royalty thunder, Thy power throughout the universe displayed. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to Thee, how great Thou art. great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. When through the woods and forest glades I wander and hear the birds sing sweetly in the trees, when I look down from lofty mountain grandeur and hear the brook sing feel the gentle breeze, then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. And when I think that God his Son not sparing sent him to die, I scarce can take it in that on the cross my burden gladly bearing he bled and died to take away my sin. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. When Christ shall come with shout of
says, in fact, you are very great, and we lift you up this morning. We exalt you, Father. We praise your holy name, and Lord, we pray that as we are here gathered together this morning to worship you, Father, we pray that you would be pleased, that you would accept the sacrifice of praise, Father, that we lift up before you, that you would accept the sacrifice of these lips, Father, in this congregation. Father, we pray that as we're here this morning and as a bit later on we listen to your word, Father, we pray that this give and take, as we hear from you, Father, and then as we respond to you, Lord, we pray that your purposes would be accomplished in this congregation, Father, both individually and corporately. Father, we pray that you would be pleased in all of this. Lord, we thank you for each one who's here this morning, and we pray for your blessing on each one. For it's in your Son's name we pray, Lord. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
We do serve a great God, and one of the things, maybe the primary thing that we all worship the Lord for the most possibly, is his creation, because that's something that all of us see. All of us worship the Lord on an individual basis for things that he's doing in our lives, but all of us share in this great creation that God has done. And so one of the songs of a few years back, God of Wonders, talks about that. He is a God of wonders. All these great things that he does. Probably one of the best examples of that is in Psalm 8, where it says that the work of the heavens, all the stars and all that, are just the work of God's fingers. It's almost like an afterthought. That's how great and how mighty our God is. Let's sing together this morning, God of Wonders.
Lord of all creation, of water, earth, and sky, the heavens are your tabernacle, glory to the Lord on high. God of wonders beyond our galaxy, you are holy, holy. The universe declares your majesty, you are holy, holy. Lord of heaven and earth, Lord of heaven and earth. Early in the morning, I will celebrate the light. When I stumble in the darkness, I will call your name by night. God of wonders beyond our galaxy, you are holy, holy. The universe declares your majesty, you are holy.
Where it talks about when I stumble in the darkness, I will call your name on high. I had a friend in a church years ago. He said he would be walking through the house in the middle of the night, get up for whatever, and stumble over one of the kids' toys or something. And he would think to himself, what is the message here that the Lord is trying to tell me? Turn on the lights. So probably not quite what the author of this song had in mind. Anyway, let's continue singing this morning. Blessed be your name.
Blessed be your name in the land that is plentiful, where streams of abundance flow. Blessed be your name. Blessed be your name when I'm found in the desert place, though I walk through the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your glorious name. Blessed be your name when the sun's shining down on me. When the world's all as it should be, blessed be your name. Blessed be your name on the road marked with suffering. Till there's pain in the offering, blessed be your name. Every blessing you pour out, I'll turn back to praise. And when the darkness closes in, Lord, still I will say, blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your glorious name. Lord, blessed be your name. You give and take away. You give and take away. My heart will choose to say, Lord, blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your glorious name.
You're the Lion of Judah, the Lamb who was slain. You ascended to heaven and evermore will reign. At the end of the age, when the earth you reclaim, shelter the nations before you. And the eyes of all men will be fixed on the Lamb who was crucified. Wisdom and mercy and justice shall reign at your Father's side. And the angels will cry, Hail the Lamb who was slain for the world. King of all kings and the Lord of all lords. There's a shield in our hand and a sword at our side. There's a fire in our spirits that cannot be denied. 'Cause the Father has told us, for these you have died. For the nations who gather before you.
And the ears of all men who do hear of the Lamb who was crucified,
who descended to hell, who was raised up to reign at his Father's side. And the angels will cry, Hail the Lamb who was slain for the world. Roll in power, and the earth will reply, You shall reign. as the King of all kings and the Lord of all lords.
Oh, Father, you are the King of all kings, the Lord of all lords. You are the Lamb who is slain before the foundations of the earth. Father, we praise you. We exalt you. We lift you up this morning, Father. Glorify yourself in our midst. And Lord, we praise you for it. For it's in your Son's name we pray, Lord. Amen. Amen. Would you stand with me, please, this morning as we read the scripture? Pastor is continuing his messages in Isaiah chapter 6. And so you follow along as I read verses 1 through 8, Isaiah 6, 1 through 8. In the year that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord sitting upon a throne, high and lifted up, and the train of his robe filled the temple. Above him stood the seraphim. Each had six wings. With two he covered his face, with two he covered his feet, and with two he flew. And one called to another and said, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. The whole earth is full of his glory." And the foundations of the threshold shook at the voice of him who called, and the house was filled with smoke. And I said, "Woe is me, for I am lost. I am a man of unclean lips, and I dwell in the midst of a people of unclean lips. For my eyes have seen the King, the Lord of hosts." Then one of the seraphim flew to me, having in his hand a burning coal that he had taken with tongs from the altar. And he touched my mouth, and he said, "Behold, this has touched your lips. Your guilt is taken away, and your sin is atoned for." And I heard the voice of the Lord saying, "Whom shall I send, and who will go for us?" Then I said, "Here am I, send me." Father, that should be the prayer of each one of our hearts. Lord, when you say, "I have a job to do, who should I send to do it?" Father, give each one of us the courage, the motivation, the desire to stand up and say, "Lord, here I am. I want to go. I want to do it." Lord, we don't even need to know what the job is. Lord, when you told Abraham to pack up and leave, he didn't ask where, how far, or when, or anything else. He just packed up and started walking down the road. Lord, let that be the attitude of each one of our hearts as well. Father, as we continue in our time of worship and study this morning, we pray that you would continue to be working in each one of our hearts through the agency of your Holy Spirit. Father, teach us what you want us to hear, what you want us to know, Lord, rather. Help us to hear what it is that Pastor has to say. Father, let us not just hear words, but let us hear from you and take those things, Lord, and apply them to our lives. And we'll praise you for it. For it's in your Son's name we pray, Lord. Amen. Go ahead and have a seat if you would.
The splendor of the King, clothed in majesty, let all the earth rejoice, all the earth rejoice. He wraps himself in light, and darkness tries to hide, and trembles at his voice. Trembles at his voice. How great is our God. Sing with me, how great is our God. And all will see how great is our God. And age to age he stands, and time is in his hands, beginning and the end, beginning and the end. The Godhead three in one. our God. Sing with me, how great is our God, and all will see how great, how great is our God. Name above all names, and worthy of all praise, my heart will sing how great is our God. Name above all names, so worthy of our praise, my heart will sing how great is our God. How great is our God. Sing with me, how great is our God, and all will see how great, how great is our God.
Oh, Father, you are so great. You are very great. And Lord, we cannot even begin to get our heads wrapped around how great you are. Father, as Pastor comes now to share with us the word that you've given to him for this morning, Lord, we pray that you would speak through him, that you would anoint him, Father, by your Holy Spirit, that the words he speaks would be your very words, Father, that you want us to hear. Lord, take those words, drive them deep into each heart and soul and mind that's here this morning, and accomplish your work in each one of us. We'll praise you for it, Lord, for it's in your Son's name we pray. Amen.
The Lord of hosts. Heavenly Father, we shudder and we tremble, for we are sinners. We have no merit, no right to stand before you. We have no strength to declare the majesty of your name and the works of your hands. And yet we find pleasure, food for our soul, as we look into your word. I pray, Lord, that you will undress us, all of our pride. Wash again our sinful feet, that we may gaze with unveiled eyes to see you, Jesus. And let that, Father, be a gaze into a transformed life, that we would not walk out of this sanctuary the same. Forgive us our sin. Focus our eyes on you. And let us truly be salt and light in this darkened world. In the name of Jesus, we pray and worship you. Amen. I remember the first time that I saw a counterfeit item made in China was in college. I didn't know that China was the land of counterfeit. If you can't afford to buy anything that you think is worthy at its given price of thousands of dollars, if you can find it in China, it'll look just the same and you can have it. Young man was walking through the hallways of our dormitory, and he said, come here, let me show you what I got. So he came by, he showed me his Rolex. I've never seen a Rolex in my life. was looking at the watch and I said, get this. Did your grandfather die? Or did you win the lottery? And I'm looking at it. It looked perfect to me. He said, nah, $25 from the Chinese market. Where can I get one of those? Was my question. Until the day I saw a real Rolex. You know, those ones that you walk into the jewelry store and before they hand you the watch, at least back in the day, you gave them your driver's license. They're not going to hand you a $10,000 watch, right? Until you gave them something worth of the same kind of value, your life. So if you look at the real watch and you put them side by side, you'll just laugh at this inauthentic, cheap copy. And that's with everything else. You can buy purses that usually cost $4,000 for $25 made in the same place. And you may think you're somebody for having this inauthentic, not genuine copy. And why do I say this? Because we're watching Isaiah experience a life-transforming vision, a life-transforming experience that brings him to a place to never be the man that he was before. He was called into ministry, and we see him calling out and prophesying and calling out the sin of the people from chapter 1 and chapter 2. But something happens here. As he meets God, everything changes. So we ask the question, what is it like to worship in an authentic presence of God? What does that look like? Do you have to walk into a small church where everybody's on their knees? Do you walk into a big church with lights and smoke and bands? Do you feel like you're closer to God when you're amazed by the sounds and what you see? What does it mean to finally worship and see the King of Kings? And so we have been walking together these first verses, and we see that he's called. His life needs to be transformed because of the ministry and the life he's about to be called God's man in the midst of a people that was stubborn and sinful and a nation that was falling apart. And the first thing that he sees that he's comforted by who God is. He's comforted by God's majesty and sovereignty, because the king died, a good king died. But God replaced whatever hope the people had, or he had in that king, with the fact that he saw God sitting on a throne high and lifted up. And in that presence, as he sees the seraphim, with two wings covering their face, two wings covering their feet, two wings flying, he hears, holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty. And that point, from within, he feels a conviction that begins to overflow into our text this morning. And it overflows into a life of servitude. And it teaches us the formula. There's no serving God unless we've been transformed, unless we've been convicted, unless we've been repenting, unless we say, now we're ready, because we're sanctified. He's comforted. He's convicted. Verse 4. And the foundations of the threshold shook at the voice of him who called, saying, holy, holy, holy. And the house was filled with smoke. We read and we wonder, we try to imagine what that looks like and try to understand, what does it mean? What is God using to get to Isaiah's heart? So Isaiah comes to a point to say, woe is me. I'm coming undone. I'm about to fall apart. For I'm a sinner. We go from being comforted, convicted, to where he's being confronted by the worship of God that he sees and what that worship must be like and the fruits of that worship. We come to church and many times we don't know what to expect, especially if we're visiting. And we get sometimes surprised, even if we've been attending here. One Sunday may not be like the other. And we're surprised by a song, by a message. And sometimes we hear, oh, you had that message for me. I've got no idea what God has for each one of us. And we feel a conviction. We're convicted when we realize where God is, where He wants us to be, and then we realize where we are really at. Kind of what our country needs. A conviction. Before we even get to the Constitution, a conviction to the Word of God, we find that as they've done polls to different campuses and they ask young people about the Constitution, they've got no idea that these truths that we stand on, and if that's true, how much do they know about the Scriptures? Oh, in the good book it says, and the man upstairs wants, and he's watching over me. We live in a world where our minds are running with the wishes of our own desires, and we got no idea about the facts. The foundations of the threshold shook. But think about it. This hit me as I was reading, that this is not any earthly structure that we know about. I was sitting last night in my chair, at my home office, which I have recently purchased and recently put together. And only last night, I realized that as I leaned back, I heard squeaking. I'm like, I just bought you. Why are you squeaking? It's because the bolts are coming undone. I got to open it up again and tighten it up again. We expect these things from the earthly structures. This is a heavenly temple, and still the foundations are shaking. This force, this declaration of holiness and presence is the same force that interrupted on one given day a king's gala thinking he was all that as a hand appeared and this hand was writing on the wall. And instead of the palace shaking, his knees shake. You know the passage, waited and found wanting. Waited, measured, and found wanting. It's the same kind of force that vetoed the crowds yelling and appraising King Herod, saying, oh, what speech! This is a God speaking. And in that same moment, he died on the throne, eaten by worms on the spot. Same force of God's presence. You see, when God's angels enter in our dimension, when God speaks to you directly, everything changes. Turn with me to Matthew 28, verse 2. Matthew 28, verse 2. And he says, and then there was a great earthquake. As the threshold were shaking, the earth began to shake. Because one angel, one, and it wasn't even a seraphim. One angel, probably just Gabriel showing up. For an angel of the Lord descended from heaven and came and rolled back the stone, and he sat on it in victory and the presence of God's power. His appearance was like lightning, and his clothing white as snow. And for fear of him, the guards trembled and became like dead men. Is that our reaction to listening to God's word? Are we shaken to the core by our sinfulness? Or we sit back and analyze, good message, good points, good text, let's listen again. We've got no idea. This happened to me a number of times, though I remember one specifically. I was called to be a guest speaker in one of the churches in Illinois. And I've got no idea. I can't tell you who was praying for me. I've got no idea. There was no great band on the stage. And I was not sitting up front. I was sitting somewhere in the middle before I got up to preach. And something happened as I'm listening and singing. I just began to wail and cry in the presence, sensing that God was there. And He was about to speak. Isaiah is not a one-off. This doesn't happen to just prophets. This is a lifelong needed experience on a regular basis in our lives. As we are brought into worship. We got no idea when we are singing and saying, I want to see the Lord. You've got no idea what it means to see God. We got no idea when people sing, "Oh Lord, let the fire come down." You've got no idea the theological implications of God's fire coming down. The post shook and smoke filled the temple. Isaiah entered into the awesome, frightening presence of the Lord. Holy in all His being and glorious in all His doing. The post shook. We hear God's voice. We hear the angelic voice crying out, "Holy." We see the smoke in the presence of God. We try these days, maybe, to emulate that experience in our services, right? There's stages of smoke coming up, the lights go down, and the band sings, and the preacher screams the top of his lungs. But is that really worshiping the Lord? What's happening here with Isaiah is no earthly manipulation of trumpets to get an effect, to tug at our emotional strings. It's an internal, personal surrender. And say, "Lord, Your beauty and holiness in my darkness. Yet, nothing but the blood allows us entrance." Here in Isaiah's experience, we are witnessing the climax of God's blessing. He's blessing up the worship offered up by the seraphim. We see this blessing as God affirms His presence in the temple. How many of our churches singing today, are actually empty auditoriums with human echoes and God is nowhere near in sight? Turn with me to 2 Chronicles chapter 7, verse 1. This blessing that Isaiah sees directly, it's what we also see in Solomon's prayer after he prays, after he dedicates the temple, after he repents and says, "Lord, when we sin and we come to You in prayer, hear our prayers from this place." As soon as Solomon finished his prayer, fire came down from heaven and consumed the offering and the sacrifices, meaning I'm here and I accept, I forgive, and You're in my presence now. The glory of the Lord, here it is, fill the temple. And we make that connection because we're told that You are the temple of the Holy Spirit. God fills your heart as you are in His presence, in His word, in prayer, in repentance. He responds by faith, filling your being with His presence. And the priests could not enter the house of the Lord because the glory of the Lord filled the Lord's house. When all the people of Israel saw fire come down and the glory of the Lord on the temple, they bowed down with their faces to the ground on the pavement and worshiped and gave thanks to the Lord, saying, "For He is good and His steadfastness endures forever." Our lives are transformed as we're convicted when we see through our heart and the Word God's being, His entity, entirely different, eternal, powerful in presence and form than anything we have ever experienced or and tears right through our flesh. We who are made of dirt and blood and sin. How do we know that God has accepted our worship? Do we treat our experience and worship in church as sometimes we do our prayers? We've been talking about prayer. And sometimes we sense that the Lord is not answering our prayer. So instead of a conversation with the Lord, it becomes, "Okay, Lord, I told You what I'm going to keep on going. You do what You want. Let me know if You change Your mind." Do we treat worship the same way? We go to church because that's what we've been doing since we were children. But there's no real grabbing of the soul. I need to be changed. You know that God has accepted our worship, accepted our prayer.
How do you know God accepted your offering? How do we know that God accepts our fellowship? Turn with me to Acts chapter 2, verse 2, and then verse 4. Even here in the New Testament, in the new experience with God, we see that when God takes audience, the world trembles. And if we were to say, hey, what's more important for the walls of this sanctuary to tremble, or for your heart to tremble? For you to hear much more than I can ever say. For you to understand much more than I can ever explain. For you to read. The Holy Spirit says, yes, you and me, and this must change, and this you've got to stop, and now you've got to start. Acts chapter 2, and suddenly they weren't praying for it. They had no idea what to expect. All they wanted was Jesus. They've seen him alive, and now they're praying because that's all they have, all that Jesus told them, and all that he was to them. They were in his presence, and God answers, not with what they were asking for, but what they needed and what was necessary. Suddenly there came from heaven a sound like a mighty rushing wind, and it filled the entire house where they were sitting. And they were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. How do you know that this morning you've worshipped and that the Lord was in this place? In his book, J.P. Allen, The Reality in Worship, likens our worship to entering a planetarium from a busy street downtown New York or downtown Chicago. You go to the planetarium, and all of a sudden the lights are dimmed, hushed, the sounds, and the universe opens up over our heads. He says, Earth becomes the smallest of planets, and we become one of its smallest creatures. In that awesome moment, we focus on the greatness, the goodness, and the grace of God. Our worship should be like that. No longer see who's here, what they're wearing, and who's not here, because all that matters is that you, at this moment, are hearing God speak to you. In any given moment, he says, we think that we're the center of the room. We're number one. But take any one of us and place us on the peak of a mountain, at the edge of a forest, of an ocean, in the middle of the forest. Something changes, and we begin to realize how insignificant we really are. In worship, how do we know that God has heard our prayer? There's conviction. We begin to be sincere and honest with ourselves. We begin to see our own sinfulness. There's repentance, that desire to way and never walk in that darkness again. There's that desire for the holiness that brings joy. There is a commitment. From now on, I understand, Lord, I repent. From now on, I will follow you, and I'm going to stay away, and I'm going to transform, and I'm going to read, and I'm going to learn and meditate. Memorize, and I will serve. There's that commitment, and then the Lord in that gives you peace. You may come to the house of God, and any given preacher may make you feel good. And you won't hear many stories like this one where sin becomes front and center, my sin. But see, after and in that message, there's given a peace in that forgiveness that no speech can ever give a man or a woman. And following up this conviction, repentance, commitment, and peace, there's the fruit. Showing that it has taken root and things have changed, and now I am walking with the Lord. Worship should not begin with a focus on ourselves, our own needs and wants. Worship begins and ends on the character of God, who He is. Endless, eternal. As the seraphim cried out, the power of their deep voices shook the very foundation of the temple. You know that thinking, were their voices deep or not? Probably not, but we know and learn, and the government uses sound technology in their defensive or offensive warfare. I looked at Wikipedia on the sound waves. I knew about this, but they're more specific. Extremely high power sound waves can disrupt the eardrums of a target and cause severe pain and disorientation. There was a test done that the sound was so deep, the level, the waves, and so powerful, it made the eyes of the people around shake and shiver, so therefore they couldn't see straight anymore. It vibrated the nerves in their head. They used these frequencies to incapacitate crowds and people for different reasons. Is that what happened? Possible. It's not the scientific physics that we can explain. Someone long time ago trying to take God's power, given word, said, you know what? When they walked around the fortress and the walls of Jericho, the sound of the feet and the vibration of their feet created these sound waves, and that's what made the walls fall down. I don't think so. When God speaks, it happens. We try sometimes to explain away the miracles that God works. Something happened in the presence of those angels that shook Isaiah's heart. He saw smoke fill the temple. As he sees this, Isaiah sees God's awesome power. The angelic agents and the powers that are executing his justice upon the earth. Most likely, the smoke was a cloud of glory that surrounds God. Symbolizes holy to Exodus 16:10. His cloud of glory, his presence, leads the Israelites to the wilderness journeys. As soon as he spoke to the people of Israel, they looked towards the wilderness, and behold, the glory of the Lord. And we see this Solomon, the Lord's temple Solomon built, also in 1 Kings 8:10. The Lord, so that the priests to minister because of the cloud, for the glory of the Lord filled the house. And this transcends the pages of history, with the cloud or not, but in the presence of the Lord. If you look at John chapter 8, in the presence of the Lord, just his word, when he uses the word with that authority and power, as he is about to be arrested, as they're looking for Jesus, and he says, I am, remember, before Abraham, I am. He says, I am he. When his enemies heard him speak, they drew back and fell to the ground. And Peter thought he had to use his sword. Sometimes we think we have to help God with our own authority and our own strength, our own wisdom. And all that Jesus says, I am. Have you met Jesus in that realm? Have you heard him speak to you through his word? In his right hand he held seven stars. From his mouth came a sharp two-edged sword, and his face was like the sun shining in full strength. Revelation 1:16. And then John, he falls, verse 17. When I saw him, I fell at his feet, dead. There's no rushing away from God's presence. That is why the Lord said that we have to go in our closet. We have to turn down the noise and say, Lord Jesus, I'm going to read what you wrote to me. Let me hear what you're saying. And it begins with, woe is me. God's love, his grace, the Lord Jesus. We see this experience over and over. John fell down as dead, and Jesus, but he laid his hand, his right hand on me, saying, fear not, for I am the first and the last. And the living one, I died, and behold, I am alive forevermore. And I'm so powerful that I've got the keys of death and Hades. This is who Jesus is. You see, God seeks people to worship him in spirit and in truth. From a broken, humble, honest heart to the truth of the scriptures, not our own imagination. We should not proceed into any worship without the expectation of being visited by the presence of the Holy Spirit every time we come into his presence in our closet or in the sanctuary. Lord, I want to hear from you. We wait in his holy presence until he comes. Just like Jacob that fought the Lord all night on the words blessed. Just like Moses that chose God's presence above all and his face shone every time he was with the Lord on the mountain. Not only does the holiness of God call out Jesus that can redeem us, but it gives us the promise that we can be imprinted with his character over our hearts. 1 Peter 1:16, be holy. And he doesn't keep it away, but he draws us near. Be holy, for I am holy. And the more time I spend in his presence, the more I become like him. It's not a suggestion, it's a commandment. What happens to, remember Naaman? That general that had all the power, but didn't have any health. And we know that, right? When you get older, money has no value. It's the most, isn't it? So here he is, this general of his commanding armies, having his armor on, but under their armor, leprosy. And he says, I need to know. And this servant girl tells him, there's a prophet in Israel. Go to him. And he goes, and he barely goes. He doesn't want to go into the river. The soldier's servant says, you know, you're here. Go ahead and take a dunk anyway, because you're here anyway. And he does, and everything changes. Here's what happens. 2 Kings 5:15. He worships. Then he returned to the man of God, he and all his company. And he came and stood before him, before Elisha. And he said, behold, I know, just like Nebuchadnezzar, I know that there's no God in all the earth but in Israel, Yahweh. So accept now a present from your servant. Whoever told him to give an offering? No one. It was a natural reaction of worship. As God blessed them, then Naaman said, if not, because Elisha said, I don't need any. Naaman said, if not, please let there be given to your servant 2 mule loads of earth. From for now on, your servant will not offer a burnt offering or sacrifice to any other God but the Lord. I need to worship. He actually says, when I go with my king and he's worshiping all the idols, I got to be there. But you know what? I'm going to sprinkle the dirt right here in the best way I know how. I want to worship Yahweh. You see, worship is not what we do between 11 and 12. Worship is a lifelong passion. Isaiah's convicted, and that conviction leads to his repentance. What Warren Wiersbe says about true biblical worship. True biblical worship so satisfies our total personality that we don't have to shop around for man-made substitutes. William Temple made this clear in his masterful definition of worship. Worship is the submission of all our nature to God. It is the quickening of conscience by his holiness, the nourishment of mind by his truth, the purifying of imagination by his beauty, the opening of the heart to his love, the surrender of will to his purpose. And all this gathered up in adoration, the most selfless emotion which our nature is capable. And therefore, the chief remedy for that is self-centeredness, which is our original sin and the source of all actual sin, to be surrendered to Him. When we truly worship, we truly surrender, and then we're being transformed. We understand worship. Take away from its holy presentation on this posturing on the shelf of Christianity. People worship all sorts of things. Jesus said that the kingdom of God is like that man that found the pearl of great price. So he went home, he sold all that he had, he went to buy land so he can own that pearl. Don't people worship their cars? Don't people worship their houses? Don't parents worship their children? Everything I do for kids, people say. We find, because we've been created to worship, when we do not worship God, we will worship everything else around us. But when we hold on to the Lord, we're set free. We're set free from all, and we begin to live. Well, so much more, so little time. Let me plant this on you. And I said, woe is me, for I am lost. I am a man of unclean lips. And you know what? I also dwell in the midst of a people of unclean lips. In all this, woe is me, for by His grace, not my merits, I have seen the King. This vision that transforms his life and brings him into worship, and actually brings you to a point to ask you what came first, the chicken or the egg? Does worship come first before repentance? Or does true repentance give birth to real worship? In this case, we see that in God's grace, He allows him to worship and see worship in such a way that he's brought down to a point of repentance. And I challenge you to search deep down and find and realize that today's biggest trouble, problem of the American church and our nation, we do not know repentance. We know a lot of show and presentation, very little of repentance. Brother Paul and I laugh every once in a while when we remember our ex-president, when he was asked if he was ever sorry for anything or if he ever repented for anything. And we may put that weight and burden on his shoulders, but I think he spoke what this nation has experienced. In other words, why should I be sorry? I never made a mistake. And we treat life that way. It's the hardest phrase to come out of our mouths. I'm sorry. I'm wrong. Or I was wrong. Oh, we'll say we're sorry. And we're thinking, I'm sorry that you're so weak. I'm so sorry that you don't understand. We stop it, I'm sorry. But we don't follow up with, I have wronged you. And this is where Isaiah is given a heart with a transforming repentance. For whenever there's repentance, things change. There's no meeting God without, there's real meeting with God without an impact, a change. Why don't we change? But rarely meet God. Because we listen, but we don't read. Oh, we read, but we don't sink it in deep to say, now what? We love the worship, but I need to be repentant and changed. Daniel 10 teaches us from the words of Daniel, thing we see it from Nehemiah. What does repentance look like? Prayer look like that changes everything? Because it doesn't matter what we look like to people, how we impress them or disappoint them. It matters if I understand that my sin offended God. Because see, if I understand His holiness, I truly see my sinfulness and I should be dead. I deserve only death, but for His grace. So I was left alone, says Daniel chapter 10, verse 8. And I saw this great vision, and no strength was left in me. My radiant appearance, I stopped that when I read it. You know what he is referring to, his radiant appearance? Go right back to Daniel chapter 1, when they were looking for these guys that were the best, they were the cream of the crop out of Israel, and they fed them the best things they had, and they said, no, we'll eat the vegetables, and they were the wisest and the best looking guys in the bunch. And he says, you know, all of that radiance, my radiant appearance was fearfully changed. I retained no strength. Then I heard the sound of his words. There's a formula here. There's some steps that are developing here. There's no hearing of the words. There's no instruction. There's no listening to the forgiveness and the sending until there's a repentance. Then I heard the sound of his words, and as I heard the sound of his words, I fell on my face in a deep sleep with my face to the ground. Ready? Verse 10. And behold, a hand touched me and set me trembling on my hands and feet. See, when we are convicted with God's presence, there's no rebuttal. There's no, but Lord, let me tell you why and how. There's nothing but, I'm on my face, naked in my soul before God. All I can use right now is Him touching me. And as He told John, do not fear. I am the beginning and the end. You see, repentance is a mystery. It's hard. From a 2-year-old that says, no, not me, I didn't do it. From a 2-year-old that says, no, no, no. To an 80-year-old, you see the gray hair in my head? Who are you to tell me I'm wrong, right? All of our lives, we fight against this repentance spirit. Our natural tendency is that our heart wants to harden. Our hearts, left alone, it will always drift towards sin, towards apathy. We quickly venture into darkness, and we easily shine away from that light that calls our sin into evidence. Repentance doesn't come naturally. Repentance is a gift from God. Repentance is grace. Because repentance ushers one into freedom and peace. God pours this gift of repentance as it overwhelms us. And these three verses is what I leave you this morning. As we want to begin this week of prayer in our homes for this nation. But it begins with my home. I need to repent. Our church, we need to repent. As we're calling for the Lord to make clear to us this vision of ministry He has for us for this time. As we are convicted, as we see His holiness, as we are called to be transformed, changed through repentance. Acts 11:18. When they heard this, they had no further objections and praised God. Well, then, even to the Gentiles. So they got a report that they've been in middle of these Gentiles and Cornelius, and they repented, they were baptized, and they were saved. They came back to Jerusalem. Here's what God did, and without even knowing it, they're speaking scripture, and they say, God is granting that leads to life. So when you pray for your wife, your husband, your family, your neighbor by name, you pray, God, in your mercy, pour a spirit of repentance over them. 2 Timothy 2:25. And this is a good relationship instruction verse. Don't argue with people to no end, trying to convince them you're right and they're wrong, because you won't touch their heart. But if you do touch their heart, it'll get hard. Opponents must be gently instructed. It's not who's wiser or louder in your arguments, especially in ministry. Opponents must be gently instructed in the hope that God will grant them repentance, leading them to a knowledge of the truth. It's God that's going to open their eyes. It's God that's going to change their heart. It's God that will bring them closer to the fellowship in ministry, not you, not me. God will grant them repentance, verse 26, and that they will come to their senses. Now, we all know that those that disagree with us have lost their sense, right? We'll always argue that. But it's not my sense that matters. It's God's truth in scripture and ministry. God will bring them to their senses and escape the trap of the devil who has taken them captive to do his will. In Romans chapter 2, verse 4, not realizing that God's kindness is intended to lead you to repentance. If you pray for a spirit of repentance and God answers, how does he do it? We wish that God would use that whip on our enemies and he would just touch us gently for us, right? But it says that God's kindness, his goodness, and now if you're working with the Lord and you're serving him, how must you treat your enemy? How must you treat your adversary? Be kind. Peter tells that to the wives. With your husbands, a spirit of gentleness and peace, that even those that may not know the word of God, without a word, they would be led to repentance by your godly attitude. Worship. Is your worship authentic and genuine? Do you experience that awakening of his presence? Are you convicted? Is there a commitment? Are you being transformed regardless of how you feel in worshiping him? May the Lord plant deeply within our church a heart of repentance, because that opens the door to the throne room of grace and ultimately power to be a witness and a testimony. Father, our patient and gentle shepherd, we love you, and we realize this love that we have is because you've placed it in our hearts. And we love the word. Each one of us individually raised before you, Father, right now, asking you to forgive us. We raise to you our hearts and that sin that so easily besets us. Forgive us. Give us the joy of the strength of being holy in you, Jesus, and yet humble and broken, and the strength to lead those around us to your throne of grace through our repentance, not our words. Have mercy on our nation. Lord, as you allow our nation to enter a time of discipline and trouble, hardship and pain, even as your own people have suffered in Egypt and in their own land. Father, give us a spirit of repentance. For the loss of our freedoms and comfort holds no value to the gain and winning the hearts of many who do not know you. Let your church live its testimony life on our knees. Answer our prayer for salvation. Let your glory shine through the gospel lived in our lives. We pray in the name of Jesus, the Almighty King of Kings. Give us a vision of Him in your word. Amen.